My Christmas village was all set up. The train is up. And then my Roomba automated vacuum decimated it. It went over the tracks. And there's been a bloodbath in Christmas Town.
Oh, no. Yeah. Dude, when you said my Roomba, I was trying to remember your nationality. I thought that was some ethnic word for your grandmother. Then my Roomba.
This is What a Joke
with Tom Papa and Fortune Feimster
on Netflix is a Joke Radio.
I'm sorry to start this off on a controversial note, but we were having a discussion earlier. Why wasn't the show named F is for Fortune?
Well, it was something we kicked around, but when we started, this was, you know, pre-Me Too, pre-people of color and gay people having a voice. It was the end of the glory days for people like me and Mike. Back when America was great again, 8 years ago.
You only went five whole seasons, holy cow.
Yeah. We heard in the halls of Netflix it could have been six. If it had Fortune
in
the title.
Been F as a Fortune.
Okay. That was what... if it could have been a little better, I was like, Jesus, Tom. You're going mean early.
He's so mean.
Well, the reason why it's great is the other guy over there that you haven't talked to yet.
Mike. Yeah, hi, Michael. Hey, nice to meet you, Michael.
Nice to meet you, too.
Let's go back, Michael. How did you start off with our pal, Bill?
Wow, you know, it's almost 10 years ago, I think, around like February or so of 2012. Amazing. I got a call from my agents, and they were like, hey, would you want to meet this guy, Bill Burr, to talk about this animated show? And I was like, oh, my God, yeah. I mean, Jesus, you know, I knew Bill a little bit. I knew his work on Breaking Bad. I went in on YouTube and watched a bunch of your stand-up, Bill, and I was like, holy Jesus, this guy, he's incredible.
He's filthy. Yeah.
He's so this can only be animated.
This guy with all this red hair on top of his head too. I had more hair on my head then too, and we just hit it off and talked about a lot about like my dad and Bill's dad and what it was like being a kid back then in the 70s and how you could just go out and play all day and come back when the lights came on and all the crazy stuff we got into. And
he told the story about how they used to ride their bikes behind the mosquito spraying truck. And it had those chemicals had that sweet smell, and like I remember like families and everybody would go out to watch it when it first came by. You'd stand in the front yard like there was like the parade of progress, America going to the next level.
We literally got on our bikes and like rode behind it like it was a parade. God. You know, we're like, oh, this is fantastic. We did too.
I literally was writing about this the other night. We had in New Jersey, they would crop dust for gypsy moths, and they would come with the planes, and it was the same thing. We would go outside and try and catch it on our tongues like snowflakes. Yeah.
Before they had warnings for anything.
No.
Chemical warfare on children that everybody was celebrating.
That's because they didn't have iPads back then to distract you. So they're like, get out of the house.
Yeah, you know what the iPad killed was the mini bar. Every house had the little, go outside, we're going to make a couple of Manhattans over here. He must have posed for this between beatings.
Frank, we better leave for the funeral home. The viewing starts in half an hour.
Beautiful. Let's do it.
Frank, you don't have to be strong. You'll be going through a lot of different feelings over these next few days. The grieving process is complicated.
Well, is relief part of the process? Because I feel like I just finished my taxes.
Frank, you must be feeling some kind of sadness.
Nah, it's like eating a bologna sandwich on white bread with no mustard. I know I'm chewing something, but there's no taste. And when I belch later, it won't remind me anything.
If you say so.
I do say so. Did the people of Whoville cry when the Grinch died?
The Grinch didn't die. Everyone loved him after he opened his heart.
I don't remember that.
That's because you turned off the TV in the middle saying, this green cocksucker reminds me of my dad.
Oh, I was having fun.
You know, such a huge part of my childhood was in the 70s. I hate how the 70s was misrepresented. It seems like the 70s started with like Saturday Night Fever and the Bee Gees and the Pacers and the Lava Lamps.
Right.
And there became this whole idea that that's what everybody was doing. It's kind of like the 60s. They acted like everybody was a flower child and went to Woodstock. Like my parents were conservative and my dad joined the Navy. He was like the hippies, you know, arguing against this company. Like, that's got a little Frank in it. More of the Serpico 70s.
Yeah.
Like that 70s show. I'll go to my grave with the first time me and my mother saw the AMC Pacer. We both said that is the ugliest car I've ever seen in my life. But now when they do the 70s, they act like everybody's like, hey, man, that's like groovy. I can get my lava lamps and my bell bottoms in here. And it's just like, you guys want to go disco fever? And it's just like, yeah, that's, I mean, that stuff was happening, but like,
right.
There's a lot of other things. So that's why the cars and everything were really important to us. Like people in the 70s didn't just drive cars from the 70s. A lot of them had cars from the 60s. High school kids would have some junker from the 50s that's now a classic that they were trying to jam an 8-track tape into, not realizing lowering the value of it. So that was a really important thing, trying to get the look of it right.
Y'all nailed all the orange and browns of the time. Yeah.
And then out of nowhere, like the lime green in the very next room.
One of my favorite parts of the whole thing is just the dadness of it. And it's animated and it's funny, but there's a lot of like real heartfelt kind of digging into like dealing with a dad that was just frazzled and at his wit's end and just can't deal. And was your relationship similar to Bill's?
No, well, it was different. It was similar, but different in a way. And that's another story that I remember telling Bill, I think at our first meeting, that eventually made it into the show after many seasons, was that my dad was the kind of guy who was very outwardly nice. He was very sweet to us. He never beat us. He never really yelled at us that much. You know, occasionally be like, go to sleep, that, you know, that kind of stuff, you know, but not the way that Frank is. But he had his own anger issues that he would take out in strange ways, you know. So he would take it out at like inanimate objects or like the Christmas tree, you know, or the TV. So this is a story that is a true story that, and you can see you're from New Jersey. So we used to watch the Mets games on Channel 9, and they would have these commercials on like 50 times a day for this thing called White Owl Cigars. And it starred this actor named George S. Irving, who would sit there with a cigar and he'd say, like, he goes, "You don't smoke White Owl cigars now, but if you do, take one puff and you will, because we're gonna get you." And that was their slogan. And he kept saying it, "We're gonna get you. Oh, we're gonna get you." And one day we're watching with my brothers, and my dad must have had a really hard day at work or something. And he literally yelled back at the guy at the TV. He's like, "You're not gonna get me, you son of a bitch." So I was like, wow. I was talking to my brother. I was like, wow, dad's got some stuff going on. That was my dad.
Oh man, I love when men describe their dads as being a good dad. They're like, he didn't beat us or anything. That's the bar.
Ah, one for you and one for me.
I'm ready to settle up on lane 14. Murphy.
Hi, sure thing. There's gonna be an extra $20 charge for the damage the diaper kit caused.
This here watermelon done gone bad.
Hey, no sweat. I'm in a good mood.
And oh yeah, your balls arrived.
What balls?
The bowling balls you ordered on the 23rd. Yeah, they just came in.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Oh. Well, maybe a different Mr. Murphy ordered them. I'm not sure who it was.
Me neither. Whoever bought these, I sure as hell don't know.
Wow, they're gorgeous. Yeah, I guess some lucky guy and his dad are gonna really love them. You know, we have a father and son league that bowls on Thursdays.
Why did you have to die? We missed out on so much. We were just about to fix it. Ah, no!
With this having been such a big part of your life for so long, is this kind of bittersweet having this come to an end? I mean, 10 years before.
The rap party was hard. The rap party, you know, when it was the final one. And I knew, you know, as much as all those people are still going to be in my lives, like me and Micah, we're going to go to Mets Dodger games every year. We've already made that pact. But like, I just knew, like, all of these people being together here right now is never going to happen again. I've gone to enough of these things, like, we'll stay in touch, and you'll get pockets of 3-4. But we had like, you know, we had like a couple hundred people there. Mm-hmm. And with, you know, Dave and Mark passing and all, it wouldn't have been the same. Yeah. Like those guys were irreplaceable. So Richardson used to take on all the 30 somethings. Like I remember when Prince died, and everyone was going, "Oh my God, it was horrible," and everything. And he just let them go on and on. And he just finally walked by the table. He goes,
Prince was overrated.
Oh, no. And he started talking about Dwayne Allman and the Allman Brothers.
Oh, my God.
All of this Dwayne Allman.
He was such a jerk that day, even got me going. I'm like, even Eric Clapton said he was the best. Like, we wasted like a half an hour, and he loved it. He sat there loving every sec, just was not going to hear it. Yeah. And then it just became, you know, you get these running jokes. Inside jokes, and that was one of them. You know, people would pitch jokes about Prince, like him being, you know, way better than Dave thought or whatever. It was just, yeah, it was a lot of that type of stuff.
It's so funny.
My favorite line Phil Henry ever did on the table reads was when he was doing Jim Jeffords. He was the local newscaster. He was the MC of some parade or something. And right. Some woman was shouting out from a float how they were going to hook up later. And his line was, "My wife is here." The way he did it, it just got this huge, huge laugh at the table read. And those are the times I would look down at, like, Richardson was always the guy, because he was, you know, sort of the gloom and doom, like, I didn't think it did that well, you know.
Right.
And so he, you know, and you'd have arguments during the week. I'm telling you, it's gonna kill. I used to have like these fights with him about jokes,
right?
And then whether it worked or not, I would look at him, you know, and if he was right, he'd be like,
yeah.
Yeah, it was fun.
So you're part of Sex Unzipped.
Yeah. It's just a bunch of like comedians and sex experts, which you couldn't find two more different groups of people, talking about sex and then having it like occasionally acted out by puppets. They made a puppet version of me, which is so much better looking than I am, which it hurt my feelings a little bit, where I'm like, how come me as a puppet is the sexiest version of me? And it's hosted by the rapper Sweetie.
Right, right. Yeah. I saw that.
Which is spelled Saweetie, but it's Saweetie. Pronounced Saweetie. Sweetie.
Hey, y'all. It's your girl, Saweetie. Making love, hooking up, smashing, knocking the boots, getting piped, whatever you want to call it, sex is a huge part of life.
The whole time I was like, Saweetie's hosting this, huh? Saweetie. And like, I had to be corrected several times.
They're like, not Saweetie.
No, like my mom saying Blink 182.
Yeah.
It was my version.